On July 4, 1776, the Second Continental Congress would sign the Declaration of Independence. This would declare America's separation from Great Britain and would make America its own independent nation. Fast forward 200 years later, America has changed a lot. Giant metropolises have popped up on every corner of the nation, automobiles and highways sprung up, American culture was at a grace period, and the nation was getting ready to celebrate 200 years of independence. From fireworks to ships gathering in New York City, parades with Johnny Cash making an appearance, and lots of colorful locomotives from coast to coast, painted in the colors of the American flag, mostly. In my personal opinion, this was one of the most interesting railroad fads in railroading history. These were the Bicentennial Locomotives. With the whole nation beginning the Bicentennial celebrations, multiple American companies would find their own ways to celebrate this nationwide event. From star stripes, ribbons in red, white, and blue, and every mode of transportation in American colors. From buses to ships, planes to garbage trucks? America's railroads, which at the time were still in a rough spot, would join the celebrations. With multiple railroad companies painting equipment in the iconic red, white, and blue of the American flag. The fad first started out in 1971, when one of the Seaboard Coastline's new U-36Bs was outshopped in a bicentennial livery with, coincidentally, the number being 1776. With any new trend, others joined in on the fun. In this case, a lot of railroad companies would continue the bicentennial fad. And I mean a lot! Major freight carriers, commuter agencies, industrial companies, belt railroads, dock railroads, tourist railroads, terminal railroads, literally any type of rail company you could think of had something painted in bicentennial colors. Even railroads that were struggling financially didn't miss out on the fun. It wasn't just limited to just diesel locomotives too. Steam locomotives, electric locomotives, boxcars, hoppers, cabooses, steam cranes, hell, even railroad buildings were getting the bicentennial treatment. Like, wow. Some railroads even managed to outdo themselves with their own liveries, both in quality and quantity. The Santa Fe would paint up five of their SC-45-2s into the same scheme, while the Pittsburgh and Shawmuth would paint its whole roster into bicentennial colors. It honestly was a giant competition for the best bicentennial livery if you were to think of it. However, despite the many companies being into the bicentennial craze, some railroads wouldn't join the fun. Some examples would include the Rio Grande, Southern, Ann Arbor, and the Maine Central, which they would only do little to no effort in the bicentennial craze. The Southern would only do a half-assed sticker on the side, while the Maine Central chose to name some of their diesels after important people. They're like those kids that don't want to participate in the school activity and choose to stay in the classroom and be on their phones. You could also argue that Amtrak didn't join the fun, but I respectfully disagree because, well, Amtrak's livery features the colors of the American flag, so you could say Amtrak was well ahead of the party, I suppose. On another note, alongside bicentennial railroad equipment, a special train would be out for the celebration, known as the American Freedom Train. The concept had been done before in 1947, but to, controversial results. This new Freedom Train would have 10 display cars converted from old baggage cars, featuring 500 iconic treasures of Americana. There is too many to list off, so some examples would include a moon rock, Judy Garland's dress, and a copy of the Constitution. The train would tour all across 48 states between April 1, 1975 to December 31, 1976, with more than 7 million Americans visiting the moving display. To top it off, three steam locomotives were selected to handle the train on various parts of the journey. First was Reading T-12101, Texas and Pacific 610, and the future Excursion Queen, the Southern Pacific 4449, all of which were painted into unique bicentennial colors, such as a Amtrak-esque scheme for 4449, a Lionel-type design for 610, and solid blue and red and white lining for 2101. At the same time, there were other steam locomotives considered for the American Freedom Train, which included Norfolk and Western 611, Nickel Plate Road 755 and 763, and Santa Fe 2925, all of which never got chosen for different or unknown reasons. Before the Freedom Train would begin its tour, a test run was set to test out the routing for the train, which would result in the creation of the short-lived Preamble Express, I think that's how you pronounce it, which was made up of four coaches, D&H U-Boat 2312, and Union Pacific 951. The test train would run from July 5th to November 14th, 1974, stopping at various stations to find out various locations for the Freedom Train, and of course, to hype up the actual train itself. In short, the test train would get a positive reception, and as they say, the rest is history. Now, onto the fun part and probably the most ambitious part of this video. In this segment, I'm going to be reviewing every Bicentennial locomotive, and I mean every single one of them. There will be a lot to cover, from tiny switchers to giant electric locomotive, glorious paint designs to whatever this turd is. I'll be taking my time to review all of these schemes in short forms, similar to my 10 words or less videos, but sorta over 10 words if you know what I mean. So, sit back, grab your stuffed puffs, a Coke, and some popcorn, and let's get into this long-ass review! Without the years on the side, I would've confused this with a Christmas unit. Stars instead of frame lining is neat, but I question the exhaust. The Alco livery is solid, the 80-tonner is a downgrade. When the Bicentennial scheme is more recognizable than the official scheme, also the fact they put it onto an Alco was neat too. Pretty basic. No stars, no special text, just plain as hell. Yellow highlights throw me off, but good design. Is it just me? But the red looks more orange. Protect this at all cost! It's too good! Good scheme for a steam locomotive, I'll say. Just hope it doesn't. The red handrails is a neat touch. Also, the hell-up is up with the front grills. Basic scheme, but a very precious little critter to make up for it. Similar scheme to Jefferson, but without cab lining and red handrails. Going out with Fairbanks Morse and Alcos in a recolored frenzy. And red stripes. Blue lining down the frame is nice, the red lining is a neat touch. Red front also cool. Basic scheme, but I love the logo on the Baldwin. Also neat touch that they decorated for the company's 38th birthday. A Lima Hamilton joining the celebrations? Well, hit me sideways then. Stars on the blue frames is definitely unique for that critter. Basic colors for a small critter, nothing more. Funky diesel, with some stripes all over the place. That painted banner on the front is a nice touch. Interesting that the red goes down to the frame. Neat plaque and neat design. The striped handrails and stripes on the nose is neat. The Alcos have a neat design on the nose. I like the white highlights and the ability for Bluetooth compatibility. The rolling stock is neat, the locomotive is meh. A lot going on in one scheme. Easily one of the many best. Do you want the stripes on the nose, or the side, or just a Minuteman? Surprisingly still in service for an obscure railroad. Belt scheme but with American colors. A classic. The outlined stripes are a nice touch, I'll say. 792 is the best one. Gotta love that stripe pattern. Basic with two stripes, nothing more. Decent amount of variety for one chat of a fallen flag. Interesting design choice for the stripe. The red cab is a no for me though. Sorry. The hell is that? The scheme reminds me of a popsicle for some reason. Fine new roads. But the scheme is out there. Solid, also based SW1001. Decent design, also some love for the fuel tank I see. Amtrak wannabe got me like, but for real, I like the front of these. Definitely nostalgic. Jeep is good. The crane, though, perfect. Blue looking a little more black, but very mid for a steamer. Decent scheme, I suppose. Little lacking for the underframe and bogies, but solid. Is it me, or is the red roof inconsistent? Goofy stack, goofy lining, decent logo, and, for an obscure short line, they cooked a banger scheme for a switcher. Cool design choice with the multicolored stars. Also that headlight, though. Basic, really. Nothing more to say. It's so out there. I feel like I've seen this scheme before. 4 stars. That's what I rate this livery as. They did well. Wait, never mind. If y'all were expecting a Mandate New Jersey joke, the joke's dead. But the scheme is a classic.
I do like the blue on the front and back. And other... I think it's fine.
Good usage of outlining and colors. The red highlights and couplers, the dark blue, it's magnificent. Basic. Basic, but adorable. Also, the hell is up with that stack, though? He just twisted a nerve there. Hey, Wickham 2? Decent. U-boat is decent, but the fact we got one of these in a bicentennial scheme is a win-win. Basic, Boston and Maine wannabe, but cute diesel. A little lacking, but fine. For a base short line, a based bicentennial scheme. So, one of my DT&I friends essentially gave his opinion on this locomotive. A basic but crisp livery, and its creator is super chill. Also, go Detroit road name. The white stripes on the frame feels a bit off. Nice touch on the inverted text. Makes it stand out a bit. Banger scheme, but why? Oh, why are the stripes not aligned? Simple design, but a timeless classic. Odd design choices. Also, the stack.
What is that? What the fuck is that?
Looks like a Western Pacific tryhard. Also, is it me? Why does it have a dome? Why does this feel familiar? Even narrow gauge joins the party in a simple style. The supposed decals low-key makes it look like it was made in the 2010s, back when they didn't buy every railroad. Decent design, and again, those the logo, the stars, and red stripes are a neat touch, and if the yellow frames as well. The definition of steel bicentennial. The best bicentennial in the Motor City.
Aloha.
The frame striping is fine, but the stars on the cab look unfinished. The scheme looks more sporty than bicentennial for some reason. Pretty simple, my dear. Small boy. Who invites steeple caps to the party? It's fine though, they're welcome. What? Ideal cement, you say? Mostly red, then blue and white. The nose is chef's kiss. The whole design is just perfect. Easily the best mainstream bicentennial unit. Or units. Locomotive is solid. Bottle car is a real vibe. Not a huge fan of the color design here. I'm sorry. A pioneering diesel too? Jesus is wild. The box cab is honestly based, and so is the scheme. The 45-tonner, though, it's just there. Nice amount of details, though. Love the yellow eagle on the sides. Love this design! Give it a medal right now! That didn't age well. What is this design? Funky spec, funky scheme, base Baldwin, a goofy but cool combo. 3 Bs. Blue, basic, boring. I will say, definitely out there, and well, I like it! No sarcasm. Decent bicentennial logo, but aside from that, simple Rio Grande looking ass. Basic scheme with a glorious keystone. Standard, but a timeless mining railroad. The diesels are mid, the electrics though, are amazing! Simple celebratory logo, neat Baldwin, and some comical spec work. The blue looks like Missouri Pacific, to be honest.
So that's why, once again, the streamlined doodlebug is the answer to everything. Hey, wait a minute! I'm in a collab? On another channel? Alright, finally I've been invited to work on a video project other than my own! Now I'm a someone. I'm here to give my thoughts on the bicentennial units of my home railroad, the Long Island Railroad. First off, technically the LIRR has two bicentennial units, the first of which being the much more well-known GP38-2s built in 1975, which are derived directly from the Milwaukee Road's bicentennial livery. Although, considering that this bicentennial livery was applied to practically every engine as delivered, this raises the question of whether they're officially bicentennial units or just a standard livery, to which I feel there's a stronger case for this livery being standard rather than for a special occasion, as some red stripes lasted all the way into the early 90s. Now, the second bicentennial unit isn't as well known since it didn't last as long and wasn't even an official unit. In addition to the Jeeps and MP15s was an order of 8 EMD SW1001s, which were limited to short freight runs and switching duties in Morris Park Yard. Sometimes, the shop crews would get creative and place decals and other stickers on non-revenue equipment, and after reacquiring number 105 from the New York and Atlantic Railway, they decided to give this engine an extensive makeover in the magical year of 2018. 105 eventually emerged from the shops in a custom bicentennial livery, likely in anticipation for the railroad's 190th anniversary in 2019, with the engine receiving many mixed reviews by rail fans, even though I personally feel it's one of the greatest and most creative paint schemes on the LIRR engine, and that's saying something considering they've been around for almost two centuries. However, the LIRR had a policy that every train must have the same livery, so as soon as management found out about this engine, 105 was quickly repainted into the dull blue and yellow livery. Thankfully, its legacy still lives on as its paint scheme was utilized in an O-Gauge Train World model, and once its paint wears off, traces of 105's custom bicentennial livery can still be found on the engine, as a reminder of this little engine's extensive repainting history. Well, glad I was able to help, and be sure to check out my channel as well, since Cal Unit Productions is scheduled to feature in an upcoming video of mine as well. Now, how's my bid for that brass streamlined doodle bug? They bid it up to how much?
Jeez, he's so thin! I like the design of the scheme. Really makes it look like an American flag. Simple design, white roof, and lining is alright. Good design for a tunner switcher, really. Quirky switcher, decent design. The red and white hood reminds me of Australian diesels.
I have several questions!
Basic, really, for a metro switcher. Modern bicentennial? Eh. Another classic and solid scheme. And basically the inspiration for the Long Island's own scheme. Handrails are whack, and design is rather packed. Island Terminal 2, Electric Boogaloo. Really out there for an SW1001 and S4. Another pair of gems. Nice design choice for a 70 tonner. Solid design again, and nice amounts of stars and highlights to go with it. A John Deere gone all-American flag on us. It's a damn good scheme for the Katie. Simply okay, but like the Monongahela. It's not Monongahela. Hold on. Just like the Monongahela's livery, simple. Another neat EMD switcher livery. Nothing more. They don't call the Mopac Screaming Eagles for nothing. Another SW livery that's totally original. Protect these at all costs. Neat bicentennial design for a naval company. Another banger bicentennial scheme for an SW1001. Need I say more? A dinky machine for a respectful historical society. Mad respects. Solid colors and great design for railroad in black. Mopac wannabe. Lots of stars, the handrails are a creative touch with the mixed colors. It's just a great one really for a short line. Slightly basic, with a few highlights. Hold on. Oh, so Panama was still a part of the US during the 70s. Okay, carry on. I like the bell and flags, but my man is boxy! A quirky creature that wants to be included, and he deserves it. Nice touch with the flag stripes on the cab and short hood. What? When you choose to turn your whole roster into bicentennial units. Also, does this look familiar to you? Well, decals wrapped around the hood and a lot of stars. It's definitely out there. What? I guess the white highlighting on the nose is neat? Aside from that, it's mid. Technically UP's only contribution for the bicentennial party, and it wasn't even in 1976. Red striping on the nose is a neat touch. Also with the blue frame as well. basic, but with big stars. 200, on the other hand, is really packing. Best one for sure. Good design, funky colors, and a concept that was tampered just a bit. Solid striping, nice frame detailing, and vibrant colors. Really screaming spirit of 76. So much going on, and I love it. Decent design for a little tonner. DS4 stripes pattern is hot. DS1 is really good. DS5 is fine. The one that started it all, and a great start for a celebration. Pretty basic, but alright. The design works. It just works! Wavy stripe is something, I guess. Baller design for a Santa Fe with some good quantity. Also, deeper! Golden P&LE. More blue! Blue striping, American logos and flags, but effective. I love the crescent scheme and all, but seriously, Southern, what a letdown. Bold colors, incredible design, and a nice variety of locomotives. Overfoamed, but a glorious debut to a popular celebrity. Basic. Again with the goofy grills. Another one that feels familiar. Weird design choice, but decent since RNC1s are underrated. Front stripes remind me of Metra. Aside from that, base scheme. Yellow lining does throw me off a bit for this one. Powerful showgirl and the best of the steam locomotives for the American Freedom Train.
The fucking winner!
I like how the stacks match with the livery. Decent design. A solid livery for the Air Force. An adorable train set with a good livery. Decent design with a, interesting appearance. Mid. Lightning round! 29 good, 124 solid, 200 okay, 202 great, 3501 good, 76 solid, and 45 mid. Like, damn, US Steel really went baller with the schemes.
Damn, that thing's fucking sexy.
Which one are you talking about? There's like a dozen of them.
Yes.
Alright. Not gonna lie, I do like the ends of the stripes, really. Neat frame pattern and... yeah, decent design. Basic. Decent at best. Another basic design, including a dinky. Star frame and double-ended design. Decent.
Sweet simplistic duo.
Basic. Again, basic, but with a neat star circle. For a public service company, they make their bicentennial units look like Amtrak. What the hell?
Youngstead, what the fuck were you thinking, dude? What the fuck is that? Okay. Good luck!
Definitely out there with two nice designs in one. Twinsies! And a decent way to end this segment off in unknown territories. With the bicentennial celebrations ending in 1977, the railroads would repaint their locomotives back into their regular schemes, and they continued their service life as usual. However, some locomotives would keep their bicentennial schemes even after the celebrations, either to showcase the creativity or because they were lazy. Many of these locomotives are still around today, either in bicentennial colors or not. I'm not going to list every example, but some of the noteworthy ones I'm going to mention. The three Freedom Train steamers had managed to find their own excursion careers. 2101 joined the Chessie Steam Program until... you know. 610 would join the Southern Steam Program, and 4449 would become a celebrity in the excursion scene and on the Hollywood screen. Many of the diesels can still be seen under different owners today, and some are even in active service. ICG 1776 serves the Alabama and Gulf Coast, Southern Pacific 3197 runs for the Indiana Harbor Belt, BN 1876 still serves with BNSF, and Bell Railway Chicago 154 still works for its original owner. Some of these have also been preserved as well. Some of these include Santa Fe 5704, Norfolk and Western 1776, Conroe 4800, and even the Seaboard Coastlines has been preserved after its interesting life on CSX. Also not too long ago, Milwaukee Road 156 had been saved from the Cutter's Torch, with plans to restore her back into her bicentennial colors. In conclusion, the Bicentennial Locomotives was a nice fad for American railroading because of how many companies participated, the variety of liveries, And the fact that this was nationwide from coast to coast, regardless of how small or big the railroads were. A question remains though, do I think something like this can happen today? Well, that's honestly a good question. I mean, Ross Rowland had came up with the idea for a sequel to the Freedom Train, but who knows how that will go. And let's be real, America's rail network is a literal shit show right now. But time will tell, really. Maybe reach out to me in 2026 during America's semi-quincentennial. What I think matters is how these companies participated in a nationwide event in a creative way. They all got together to celebrate the bicentennial of the land they called home. The hype back then seeing these locomotives in your local area must have been nice for the average rail fans. And honestly, I can imagine that really, even if some of them are repainted or no longer with us. They will always be remembered by rail fans as America's Bicentennial Fleet. Hello, everyone. I hope you did enjoy this massive video. This took a lot of research to go through. There was like 100 or so locomotives to talk about and giving my personal opinions on them. I also want to give a shout out to some of my friends from America for actually giving their own opinions on some units. Even PenzyFan19 also made a cameo, which I also give credit for. I recommend checking out his channel to see some of his videos, and as he said, I might appear in one of them. I'm honestly glad though I got this big video out of the way though. And I do hope you did enjoy it. Also, I want to wish my American followers a happy 4th of July. Hope you do enjoy this celebratory day. Also, please stay safe out there. I did hear about the smoke and the storms that have been happening in America. I wish you all stay safe out there. And hopefully this video was a good 4th of July special for this channel. Even if I'm Canadian. Anyways, I don't have much to say, but hope you all have a nice day, and I'll see you all in the next video. Take care, folks.